Thank you so much, and thank you so much for coming out to this talk on pre-crime at the National Arts Club. I'm going to talk about an uncompleted art work. Bela, can you that's very distracting Austrian guy thing there. I'm going to talk about a triptych, an art trilogy, where only the two first parts are completed. And the first part is called ID Sniper. It's from 2002. And the second part is called Face Jagger. And the Face Jagger is from 2015. So there's 13 years between these two art pieces. So I'm going to ask you to go on a little journey into the space-time field with me, and we're going to make one stop in 2006, where I will show you a little, which will be a little break in the middle, and I will finish up with a few words of the third and uncompleted part of this triptych, which is called Bioweapon 23, which is going to be completed in 2018. And I just want to get a little bit of the terminology straight. I use the word triptych, which is a little obscure, kind of obscure art term for an art piece. And it is kind of crucial for me to insist that this is art and not journalism. Art has different standards than journalism, and art has a longer history than journalism. And that's part of the philosophy behind this project. So let's take the next slide. So this talk, even though it's taking place at the National Arts Club, will be fairly arts-free. This is more like a sneak behind the scenes of the creation of an art piece, more than it is about the art piece as it is presented in an art institution. Both of these two projects ended up being presented in art institutions. The ID Sniper was presented first in New York, at The Thing, which was run by Wolfgang, who's sitting here in the first row, back in 2004, and was also shown at Frankfurter Kunstverein at a show called Populism, back in 2005. And Face Jack has been shown once at Aarhus Kunsthal in Aarhus, Denmark, in last year. So again, we're going to be short on art references. I would say one thing before I get started. I am influenced by land. I'm very inspired by land art. I love the audience, that there's no audience for land art, and it's done in secret. It's created in secret. And I'm also taking great inspiration from early feminist art, especially the way they ignored all male-dominated institutions. This is art that took place outside any institution. It was created outside any art system. Okay, so enough about art. Let's go into reality. And next slide. So yes, I already said that. We're going to go on the space-time loop. You got that part. Let's move on to the next one. Okay, so a quick word on the word pre-crime. I'm not sure how many are familiar with this term. It's a term that is at least 100 years old, but it's a term that was popularized by the science fiction writer Philip K. Dick in his short story Minority Report. I think it's from 56. ID Sniper was made in 2002, actually 6 months before the movie, Steven Spielberg made a movie out of Minority Report. ID Sniper was actually made a little bit before that. But pre-crime is a term by Philip K. Dick to describe crimes not yet committed. And again, it's a satirical science fiction term, but people are starting to use it more and more, especially after 9/11. A good example of pre-crime in New York would be stop and frisk that Mayor Bloomberg implemented, where people are basically stopped before they have committed a crime. I will also talk a little bit later about Scandinavian pre-crime, which is one of the biggest inspirations for the ID Sniper as well. So that's pre-crime. Again, pre-crime is only the theme. The shape of the project is some kind of homemade performance art. Let's look at the next one. So we're going to start with Face Jagger, and let's get the next one. And I was 13. It took me 13 years to make a follow-up to ID Sniper, which is a fairly long time. I wasn't on drugs, I was a little bit on drugs actually, but I wasn't addicted. The reason why, let me tell you, the reason why it took so long time was, first of all, ID Sniper was a post 9/11 art piece, and I felt I felt I pretty much nailed it. I didn't want to do a cheap imitation of what I did. So I was basically waiting for the political reality to change. And when I first heard about this Stuxnet, which is an American cyber weapon that was implemented against Iranian nuclear reactors in 2010, I heard about this was secret CIA stuff, but it went public in around 2012-13. And when I heard about this, I was really ready to get working again. This was the first time America had used a cyber weapon, so that was a big inspiration for the project. Let's get the next one. And another inspiration for the project was I met a fascinating scientist at a wedding in Costa Rica, and he was a Pakistani computer scientist. And unfortunately, this wedding ended in divorce, but it was a very, very beautiful evening just because of one thing, because I ended up sitting next to this wonderful man. And I would give you advice, if you ever sit next to a computer scientist from Pakistan, I would pay close attention to what he says. If you sit next to a computer scientist from Pakistan who lives in Washington, D.C., you should really pay a lot of attention. So I locked into this guy, and we really got along well, and he... just told me, do you know how they called Bin Laden? And I was like, no, I don't know. Please tell me. And he knew from companies in D.C., there's a lot of private high-tech companies in D.C. that works with CIA, that they used biometric face scanners in villages all over Pakistan to locate people who looked like Bin Laden. The idea was that if they looked 85% like Bin Laden, they might be relatives to him, and therefore he might be in that village. And that's Wired magazine actually wrote about this. Is what we see up here. This is a CIA guy who scans the eyes of who does an iris scanning on a Pakistani man in the village. I also had a location for it. I wanted to present this fake thing at a security and surveillance fair called ACES 2015 in Anaheim, California. I didn't quite know how this project should took shape, but I went to a 3D print fair in Chelsea, and I saw some 3D printed faces that came from a company called What's My Face, something silly like that. And they looked very, very, I felt like I was in this Cronenberg movie. They looked hyper horror realistic at a nauseous level, and I knew I was going to work with 3D printed face masks. So I got some face masks made of me and some other people, and I got them delivered. And that's how that looks like. So again, this hyper-realist, you can achieve very easy. You do it just from photography. And it's fairly easy to present stuff at a surveillance fair. It's expensive also. It costs $5,200. I used a fake name. You can see it here. It says Jakob Salomon, which is my middle name. But it was such a half-assed thing, which sometimes these things turn out a little half-assed because you're in a hurry and you work alone. So I had to use my real name because I had to use my credit card to pay the $5,200. And that was already a major worry, but things went fast. And this turned out to be a slight little problem, but you'll learn about this later. But so this is basically the weapon, and the ID Sniper was easier to explain. This weapon is harder to explain. It taps into something we all know from B movies. I think there was a movie called Face Off by John Woo. There was a Humphrey Bogart movie. Maybe people can help me with that title, where Humphrey Bogart has a face transplant. Nobody knows this movie. Okay, it's fine. It's a beautiful movie.
Snake in Old Lace, there was a face transplant.
There you go. There's a lot of movies with face transplants. It's a classic theme in movies. So I wanted to do something about how you hack at people's faces. So the idea is that you from a photo of an ISIS video, you take a screen dump from an ISIS video. That's another premise for this project, that ISIS was starting to do these high-definition videos that was really had high production value. So you take a screen dump from one of these ISIS videos. From that, you create a 3D preparation. From this 3D prep, you create a 3D mask. This is where it gets a little tricky. With this 3D mask, you put this 3D mask on a body double, a person who looks like the person you want to incriminate, and then you film this person in an incriminating situation. Let's say it could be an ISIS terrorist at a strip club, or on a more lethal scenario, it could be an ISIS terrorist in contact with federal American agencies that would get that person killed. I just read a book about one of the only people who infiltrated Al-Qaeda was actually a Danish criminal guy, and I read his autobiography, and he had very vivid descriptions about how there's a high level of suspicion for spies in Al-Qaeda, and they just basically execute people who they suspect of being spies. So let me see here. Again, yeah, I made a fake website. And again, the premise is this, that cyber warfare is no longer Russian. Cyber warfare is an American thing. That's the main premise for this weapon, which is a real premise. It's a real thing. It has been this way since Stuxnet. And I tried to, as best as I could do, to create this corporate speak. So it was presented like this, like the Syntex Corporation is proud to present FaceJack, a new tool that allows authorities to stop crime before it is committed. We use existing 3D print technology to create online videos which will incriminate and neutralize potential terrorists. I did not put my phone number on. I had bad experience with this from a former project. So I wrote, if you really want to talk with us, just shoot us an email. So if you're ever suspicious about people, if there's a website you believe it's fraudulent, if they don't have a phone number you can call, they probably are. And again, this is the general concept. You take the photo, you prep it, and you infiltrate reality with this simulated and hacked face. And so that's how that works. So I flew alone to Anaheim, California, which is the home of Disneyland. And I stayed at a little Blue Boy motel, not a very glamorous experience. And this is from a video. This was before. This is a poster that you just saw. And this picture is after. So this is my corporate look here, and this is me hanging out with the surveillance profiteers. And I had a fake business card made. I used my old Danish address of mine, even though I haven't lived there for 11 years, because I was nervous. Well, I didn't want to get deported or lose my visa or anything like that. And I thought, well, it's always good to play the foreign bird card. You could always go, I didn't know, you know. I didn't know how you Americans did it, that you could. So I used my Danish identity for that. And this is the opening of this is the first day of the fair. It's the setup. And that's how that looks like. It's very Californian, very relaxed, and still with this techno fetish. Let's see the next one. And I realized quickly that there's some serious speakers at this fair. Raymond Kelly, former commissioner of New York Police Department, is speaking. Former CIA director Michael Hayden, General Michael Hayden, is speaking. And former General James Mattis, who's now is the American Secretary of Defense, is also speaking. I mean, this is only 1.5 years ago, but back then it would be a 1 in 100,000 shot that any of these people would ever be heard from again. They were basically already in a dustbin of history. Obama had fired James Mattis, there's often surprising twists in reality. And this is the opening. A little ceremony with a little military band. And let's see the next one. This is Michael Hayden, CIA, former CIA director speaking. He's a lot in the media these days because of this kind of proxy war between Trump and CIA. He was a very slimy guy, but very smart, intelligent man, paranoid and slimy. But interesting to listen to. You couldn't take photos, so I had a little photo, exactly the same photo as Bela has right there. Like that was, I had a small camera, and I didn't want to bring a big camera, and I thought I'm just gonna wing it. It's hard to have a photo prohibition nowadays in 2000, and this was 2015, and I had my small camera, and I had a few problems, but generally it worked out okay. So this is again from the opening. This is a Danish company. I'm born in Denmark. Or did I say that? This is a partly Danish-owned company called G4S, which is one of the biggest private prison operators and in the world. They also run what they call interrogation chambers, which is basically corporate speak for torture chambers. It's a stock operated. You can invest in them. It's generally, there was a lot of surveillance stuff. There was also old-fashioned web. This is like, high-tech weapons. This is a lethal weapon. This is a thermal machine gun. There was a lot of, this is custom guns. But most of the stuff was actually stuff to prepare America for the new surveillance state. There was lots of companies that had the name Face in them. There was lots of software that sold. There was a lot of face recognition software of one kind or the other. Let's see what we got next. So this is basically how I was presenting. Some of the first so-called customers I met were Jim and Lorene from DC, from State Department. And I was fairly, I was a little stressed out because this was a weapon that belonged in a B movie, belonged in a John Woo movie or Lace and Arsenic. It was a very far out weapon, and I was, the moment you present it in real life, you realize what if people just say this is not true. So I had spoken with a friend about these concerns. And she was from California, she had a really good point. She just said, well, if they ask these questions, just say one thing. If Hollywood can do it, we can do it. And I started to get really nervous. I could see Jim and Lorene was stiffening up a little bit. I ended up just saving myself by saying, if Hollywood can do it, we can do it. And Lorene was just like, that was exactly what I was gonna say. Which is also one of the premises for FaceJagger. We have entered the era of total simulation of the simulacra. Soon we can't tell the difference between 3D graphics and real life, and that's kind of a part of the premise for this project. So people took it seriously. It was hard to, I must confess, it was hard to do business with CIA. It was hard to meet CIA. There's a little anecdote about this, or FBI, or Secret Service. But people did take the project seriously. I met a gentleman called Derek from Canada, who sold biometric lock systems. And I went over to him and talked with him. So a biometric lock system already exists in New York City. There are buildings in New York where you can only enter if you get your face scanned, and if it's not you, does this sound right? If it's not you, you can't get in. So he sold these biometric lock systems. So I was curious. So I asked him. My product is not made to hack locks, but I'm just curious, if somebody was wearing my 3D printed mask, could they hack themselves through your lock system? And he was just totally, took this question totally seriously. It was just like, no, because look here, and he pointed at some part of the camera. This is an infrared camera, and the infrared camera can detect if heat comes from the face. So no, you couldn't do that. So he was down with the main premise of the weapon. So I tried to sell, my dream was to sell it to meet CIA people, FBI people. Unfortunately, they kind of operate on the slogan, we don't call us, we'll call you. I tried to attend a former, you could like, ISVP, there was two breakfasts. There was a Christians in security, I'm not making it up, Christians in security breakfast, prayer breakfast. I'm in Europe, I shouldn't even know what that means. And then there was an FBI, former FBI agents breakfast, and there was a former Secret Service breakfast. And you just ISVP, so I ISVP'd to the former Secret Service breakfast. And this is the coldest, you know, this is the coldest email I ever got in my life, because the answer is simply no. I decided I think I will skip that breakfast, and just by accident, let's get the next one. This is maybe a little hard to read, but there was a former FBI agent breakfast just next door, which I basically ran into by accident. And I thought, okay, I thought it would be like a snack affair. It sounds like a Larry David kind of thing. I thought it would be like a stand-up thing where people would have snacks and I could like be friends with the FBI. But to my horror, I come in there and everybody are seated around big round tables with white tablecloth. And so they sit down, which was a main anxiety provoker, because then I had to sit down with these people. Not only that, while they were sitting down, they started to introduce themselves. So it was like, yeah, my name is Karen from Virginia. I started to work for the agency in 92. My name is Bob. So I was just like, well, I better not sit down here. So I basically just stood and ate. It was the longest breakfast in my life. Just stood in the corner eating croissants for 5 long minutes and got out, got the hell out of there. And outside they played a David Bowie song, Starman, which, anyway, these things are not like they're portrayed in the movies, they are much crazier. So to finish the Facejagger project off, I would say that it's a project that deals with the era we are living in, and we are entering the era of the simulacra. We are entering the era of total simulation, total simulated social connections, like Facebook, social networks, simulated erotic systems, pornography, simulated financial systems. It's not real. It's what the postmodernists wrote about in the 80s. That the sign has become more real than the signified. We have entered this age, and soon it will be hard to tell the difference between so-called real life and so-called, I shouldn't use the word so-called, and simulation. And it's something that Hollywood has to deal with, and the Democratic Party has to deal with. If they wish to survive. So some of this is about like fighting fire with fire. I totally do not believe in the if they go low, we go high approach. That's not it. We are in the middle of a huge brutal war, and we can't insist on fighting with old methods. So that was Facejagger, and there's going to be a little intermission now. There was a side effect with Facejagger. The guy, the new Secretary of Defense, he was speaking, and I recorded him. And then when Trump appointed him Minister of Secretary of Defense, I leaked the audio of the record. Well, basically, this, and I'll play it to you now, he said that the Iraq War was a mistake, and I was shocked when I heard that. He was the guy who ran the Iraq War. He was responsible for Fallujah. He basically created ISIS by mistake. This was the most brutal piece of American warfare since My Lai massacre in Vietnam. This guy did it. Let's see if we can hear.
Second point about the invasion of Iraq. I believe that. Look, Dave, is this going out to the media? It could be recorded, but is that for internal or? Well, let me just put it this way, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I got myself an early hire at Stanford University, thanks to my old big mouth. Ladies and gentlemen, we will probably look back on the invasion of Iraq as a mistake, as a strategic mistake.
So I leaked this to The Intercept, and they put it online next day. I mean, they wrote the next Monday. Let's see if we can go there. And it spread, but the idea was just to keep him accountable for that. So now we have it on record that he said it was a mistake, because this guy's talking about making a war on Iran, so at least we have his track record, he's on the record of saying that. But anyway, that was a little side effect from that project. And this is the intermission. This is 2006 for a project that wasn't completed. It's called Main Catcher, where I presented a fake computer game, a propaganda computer base. So this actually isn't pre-crime. This is a little mid dinner delight, and it takes place in Qatar, where I'm trying to sell a computer game at a weapons fair in Qatar. Let's see.
I am Hufgren. I'm from Copenhagen, Denmark.
Hello.
Hufgren, Copenhagen, Denmark.
Hello. Yeah, nice to meet
you. Where are you from?
Kuwait.
Ah, okay. So you came here only for the fair?
Yes.
Okay.
For riot control, there's no better product out there.
Yeah.
You come in and go and scare them and have them run away.
Yeah, yeah.
If that doesn't work, I can go down and put a wall of pepper powder, or I can actually go on the individuals themselves. It's going to give you the sensation that you can't, because you're not getting oxygen. Mm.
I am Hufgren. I'm from Copenhagen, Denmark.
German weapons.
This is the famous, MP5 submachine gun, caliber 9mm by 19, Parabellum. Mm-hmm. Standard. This is the most sold submachine gun worldwide. If it's, let's say, if he's attacked by one, yeah, you shoot maybe single fire. Mm. If it's more than one, you have three or bursts. Yeah. You keep it open, yeah, like this.
Okay,
this
is, so you can,
yeah,
okay.
You see everything, all movements,
yeah.
Moving targets, mm-hmm. Yeah. Very fast aiming shooting.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And it's German quality, yeah?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, very fast aiming shooting. I guess we have to speed it up a little bit. So, it's finishing here, yeah. Let's see. Let's go to the next one. So we're back in 2002. ID Sniper. So ID Sniper was basically a post 9/11 art piece. The project actually started before 9/11. It was being published by this magazine, which I co-edited. The editor, he wanted me to go to a weapons fair in China with a weapon. The idea was to make fun of Danish design. He wanted to have an ergonomically correct clubs, so the policeman could hit the demonstrators without hurting their wrist. Very Danish logic. But then 9/11 happened, and I told him I don't want to go to Beijing for a cheap joke. I wanted to do something really serious. That was my idea. I didn't know again what shape this piece, this weapon would take, but everything changed when I met this guy. He's called Christian von Bengtson, and he's the guy I designed the ID sniper rifle with. Let's just see how. I should explain. He fired Denmark's first suborbital rocket. So Christian is he's a real industrial designer. I knew him from the Art Academy, where he had made a space capsule as his final thesis project. And I was like, I need you to help me design a. I'm going to a weapons fair in 2 weeks. Please help me design a weapon. And we got together, and we designed this rifle. I basically told him I want to create like a post Tiananmen Square weapon. I was very when I saw Tiananmen Square. When was this? 89, something like that. Yeah. I was very surprised by how the Chinese authorities just butchered all the students without, you know, this was being filmed. But of course, this was in China at least, the pre CNN era. The perception that the media had the power that it hasn't really kicked in. So I wanted to make a post Tiananmen Square weapon. So this was the weapon we came up with. It was a GPS microchip-based identification rifle. Basically, the idea is that you shoot a GPS chip into the body of a demonstrator. While you shoot this chip in, you will take a digital photo, and you will thereby have this person tagged. And then you will apply the punishment after the TV cameras have left the scene. And we present it. This is how it looks like. And we have a little animation also that shows how it looks like. But basically, this is how we presented ourselves. We said Empire North. I got the name there was some snobbish Finnish architects that had a project called Ocean North. Maybe some of the architects in the house are familiar with these people. And I thought I'm going to riff on that. So it's called Empire North. And our slogan was the logical solution, a play on the horror Nazi slogan. So it was the idea was to create the worst weapon you could imagine. And this is how we present ourselves. And again, the Danish design approach again turned great because you have a certain leeway in communist countries when you say you're from Scandinavia. It's considered this weird interzone between capitalism and communism, which is also is in a way. So we present ourselves like this. We said Empire North is a young progressive Danish high-tech company committed to developing new tools for solving the problems of the 21st century. We combine outstanding know-how, a network of gifted ad hoc consultants, a flair for Danish design and creative thinking, always focused on discovering the logical solution. And this is basically, this little animation show how the concept works. The ID Sniper is a high-powered sniper rifle that can implant a GPS microchip into the body of a human being. It works as a long-distance injector, and the microchip will enter the body and stay there, causing no internal damage and only a small amount of physical pain. It will feel like a mosquito bite lasting only a fraction of a second. At the same time, a digital camcorder with a zoom lens fitted within the scope takes a high-resolution picture of the target. So basically, me and Christian was in a frenzy to get this weapon finished in time. We were working on a crazy time. We had like a week or something like this. And the main question was like, what if people ask you what happens to the GPS chip once it's injected into the human body? And there was I asked this question to Christian, and he was like, I don't know. Let's think about this tomorrow. And the next day was basically, what should we answer if people answer that question? We never came out with anything that could answer that question. And basically, the day before I left, the editor of the magazine, he came to my house and said, I'm canceling. You can't do this because this is irresponsible. China's a military police state, and nobody will believe this weapon. And you have to go back to the little ergonomically correct club. And I was like, are you kidding me? I was leaving in 24 hours. So I was like, this is way too late now. And he was basically like, well, I'm not responsible. Oh, thank you, my friend. And I went to China, a place I've never been before. It's probably different today. I haven't been back since. This was 2002. A lot of police propaganda, a lot of police everywhere. For me, it seemed like I was also jet lagged, but it seemed to me like a perfectly schizophrenic country. You had huge Prada shops, and you would see hordes of teenage communist soldiers marching by the Prada shop singing communist songs. I mean, this shouldn't happen. This doesn't make sense. So I was there. Oh, Hamburg. Yeah. Let's skip the Hamburg photo. I was in Hamburg before for a show, but that's not too boring. So I come to the fair finally. The Danish flag is there. Just I'm the only Danish corporation at the fair. So they raised the Danish flag for me. And that felt good. I mean, I should say at that point I was a little in a, I was jet lagged. The weird shit happened at a hotel. They asked me to move a hotel room. I had to move a room for a reason that was never explained to me. But apart from this, things were pretty okay. I went there, I saw the Danish flag. I'm going, okay, this is pretty smooth running. And I got my name tag, and I thought, I was nervous again about being discovered. But the woman I asked for assistance, she was the only woman who spoke English. She basically told me, I can't help you. I just came to Beijing 2 weeks ago myself. So I realized that China was at 2002 was a gigantic Klondike, where the money was flowing freely and people were coming and going. So that made me feel good. I could sort of disappear in the crowd. A lot of corporations were there. BMW were there to sell police cars. This is one of the first sites I saw when I entered the National Agricultural Hall of the people where the weapons fair took place. And at this, first of all, I only have a poster and some 500 printed business cards. And at this point, I see BMW have a $100,000 pavilion. There's Russian state weapons dealer, and I just I met with a complete mental resistance. This, they're never going to believe me. This is never going to work. Why would they believe me? And not only that, it's. I believe I was going to some sort of police fair. The fair was called China Police 2002, and they have. Things like this. Now, this was before the term militarized police was widely used, but this is basically what that's for. Honda sold motorbikes. I would say that a weapons fair on arms fairs, as is probably the correct term, is one of the least racist places in the world. It doesn't really matter as long as you have money. Everybody does business with each other. It's probably still misogynist. Most women were selling weapons or motorbikes in this way. There's a Chinese weapons dealer. Let's get to the next one. One thing that also really surprised me was that there was a lot of automated weaponry, a lot of robotic weapons, and this is a robot. This is a bomb detonating robot. But this was before also you had heard about drones, and I was again struck by this development of machines that on remote control could kill humans. There was quite a few of them. This I believe is a French company that makes. These products. This is a scan from one of the catalogs I got from the weapons dealers of a. This is a robot who has executed a half-dead suicide bomber in Israel. So again, this is. I grew up with all this. There was a lot of great science fiction movies in the 80s, and the idea that robots now could kill humans struck me as something completely novel. But such is normalization that you know now everybody's Obama made drone warfare very, I guess, normal. So this was how this was back in 2002, and this is how I presented myself. This is taken by a Brazilian weapons dealer from a company called Velsa Itage, and we will meet him here soon. I think the next one. This is the guy that took the photos. This is Federico. Federico's wife and her sister. These were Brazilian weapons dealers. And they were very friendly. I must say that weapons dealers are a lot more friendly than art dealers. And I think before we fix that, we will not fix the world. And the Brazilian weapons dealers basically told me, you know, this is a great product. A lot of the prisoners in Brazil, they live in jungle prisons. They escape all the time. But with your technology, we can keep them safe. And they also start to ask this question. But what about what happened when you shoot the chip into their body? And I basically did the whole corporate spiel. I basically said, you know what? I'm here to meet people like you, Federico, and I'm glad I met you because I'm here to get feedback from people like you. And this is a working project. And he just like tapped me on the shoulder. It's like, I know some great guys in Sao Paulo. from Taurus, one of the biggest ammunition manufacturers in the world. And they, you know, set up a meeting, they'll help you figure this out. So that approach turned out to work okay. Federico's card. So basically, the whole weapons fair is a bizarre place. This is like a newly wed couple getting photos taken in front of a police helicopter. I'm going to get back to that, but I actually feel it's just coincidence that this project took place in China. I see this as a very Scandinavian project. I will get to this in a second. But I didn't know that, but I had basically ended up in one of the biggest weapons markets in the world. China had a 17% growth rate at this point. They had just joined the WTO, and Federici told me he already had signed two contracts. So there was a lot of money going around. And a lot of stuff being sold to keep the surveillance, the Chinese surveillance state running. Okay, I'm gonna wrap this off, but I just have to finish it off. One anecdote: I met a guy called Jason Fong, who was very curious about the weapon, and he ended up setting up a meeting with me and a representative. And basically, this woman offered to find production facilities and a personnel and funding for this weapon. And at this point, it was a little bit like being caught in a science fiction novel that you'd written yourself and you somehow couldn't get out of. And I basically said, you know what, I'm very responsible for my employees and I can't just, you know, I can't just leave Denmark. But anyway, they basically offered me money. I went back to Federico and said, I'm not sure how serious these people are. Is this real? And he said, yes, it's very real. I signed two contracts. The money is flowing freely. And he just said, don't give any technical specifications away. Just look what happened to the DVD market. Everywhere on the fair, I see how they copy European and American guns. So at this point, it was a little, and I also heard the Minister of the Interior had stopped by, looked at my booth. At this point, it was time to throw in the towel, and I decided to leave the fair. And I wrote a little anecdote. This is Federico. I left China, and in the Beijing airport, I met a Japanese businessman. I was still a little shell-shocked over the experience, and I just asked him, I saw so many police, it seemed like such a militarized and police state, and I asked him, are there as many policemen in Japan? And he just said really simple, well, in Japan, there's less difference between rich and poor, so there's less police. And these things boil down to economy, they really do. You know, police state is a system you need to enforce financial oppression of people. This is an email from the project when it was shown in New York in 2004, kind of blew up again, and we start to get emails. Christian had presented the weapon as if it was real, and we started to get emails from people who wanted to buy the weapon. We also got emails from big American corporations who wanted to come to this art show, basically. I actually didn't know he did that. The Christian had sent out a fake press release saying this would be a presentation of the ID sniper. This is Paul DeMattis from Prudential Financial, who wanted to check it out. These are some notes I put here. The general thing, just to wrap it up, is the idea is to hack reality. The idea is to create, instead of creating things, instead of making things happen. Let's see the next thing. And I also, I should finish this up on a few notes on pre-crime. I do think pre-crime is a notion borrowed from Philip K. Dick. It's a notion that's very relevant today with stop and frisk. It's a notion that I grew up with in Scandinavia, where there was a thing called SSP, which was stood for social services and police. There was a collaboration with these units so that it could prevent people from committing crimes. But not only that, if you look at the history of art and the drawings that you see on a cave wall is really pre-crime. Those drawings of buffaloes are made to enhance the luck of the hunter. And in that sense, it's a depiction of a crime not yet committed. So it's 100,000 years old. And I think we should wrap this up. Somehow I see a lot of people waving. And Ava's going to ask me a few questions. Then we're going to do a little Q&A. But hey, thanks for coming.
Jakob, congratulations to this project. It's hysterical realism, I would call it. You've been very brave in that sense. What I found really interesting about this project is that part of the process was also to expose your own vulnerability in all of this. Can you tell me a little bit about like how was this all planned the way it was? I mean, it says in one of your books that at a certain point you were like so nervous to be exposed that you dropped some clonopin.
Well, sure, but I must say in China I wasn't really nervous to get found out by the Chinese police. It was more some kind of existential dread. I felt like a teenager going to a party I wasn't invited to. That was the feeling. To be honest, I was never nervous about getting found out by the Chinese police. I really wasn't. It just felt existential wrong to lie to people. And also my uncle was worked for Boeing, and he which is one of the biggest weapons manufacturer in the world. He didn't sell weapons. He sold civilian airplanes, but he basically went to fairs like this his whole life, and my own father was in the American Army. So it kind of fucked around a little bit with some social coding, but I wasn't afraid to get found out. In America, it was a little bit different because I'm not a citizen, so that's why I had to leave the FBI breakfast.
But you're also not really nice to yourself. I mean, you're so nervous and. And there's a lot of like feeling of shame. And did you feel like an accomplice? Did you think like you were giving people like these authoritarian regimes some ideas?
Sure. I mean, that was why I left the. That's why I left the weapons fair in Beijing one day early. But the thing is, and it's banal, but it's true that reality is always wilder than fiction. And me and Christian did some research, and we actually found a guy who did similar stuff in Florida, a GPS weapon.
There's
no moral. It is in a moral gray zone, but basically everything you can imagine being developed is being developed. That's the general rule.
Mm-hmm. Do we need more fictionalized or more like staging in order to get a better grasp of reality right now? It seems like this is all like, you know, when I talk about like hysterical realism, this is all like, you know, going around a total vertigo of reality. And I think like at this time, this is particularly relevant.
Yes, this is a long discussion, but I'm totally against using the word post-truth. I think that's a counterproductive term, because in a sense, we've always been living in a post-truth world. I mean, it's healthy we have this discussion. We have a reality TV star who's a president, but it's a problem. Yes. But what was the question again? What should we do?
Whether actually fiction is a better tool to deal with reality than journalism or than facts.
Oh yes. Oh yes. I'm convinced about this. You know, I grew up with the. I remember growing up in the 80s how the fiction movies about the Vietnam War changed completely everybody's perception of what that war meant. You know, fiction is a much stronger tool than journalism. I really think so, that these movies changed how people looked at the Vietnam War. So I feel that especially the left wing or the Democrats have a too serious relationship to the power of fiction, you know, mm-hmm. to the power of narrative. Bernie Sanders should have won because he had, you know, he was a better storyteller. He should have won. But he wasn't because of the internal structures of that system. So yes, we need to look at the power of fiction. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So is that also? Would you say that? Okay, we're in a time where we're totally seduced by technology. We live in a brave new world, and we voluntarily submit ourselves to these authoritarian regimes. Is there a way out, or is the only way out getting deeper in?
Yes, I mean.
I mean, that's what a lot of your contemporaries suggest.
Getting deeper into what exactly?
To these kind of systems, and to.
When me and Christian designed the ID Sniper back in 2002, we already knew it was a piece of satire. We already knew. People forget this, but mobile technology was much more developed in Europe than in America, and we knew that in the future people would be able to be tracked with mobile phones. So we already back in 2002 we knew this was just a piece of very crass satire. That's how we felt it was. We didn't know anybody would take it seriously. We didn't think so, because this is the deal that the Huxley was right. People are controlled with pleasure, not with pain. You know, so. So that's the main thing. How do you deal with people controlled with pleasure? I don't know. Maybe people should meditate. I don't know.
Okay. The Triptychon indicates that there's going to be a third part of this investigation, of this artistic investigation. What are you planning?
Well, yeah. So the third installment I wanted to be take place in Europe. The whole triptych would be take place in the three dominant empires of today: the Chinese Empire, the American Empire, and the Europe. You can also look at Europe as an empire. So I wanted to do a project about fascism in Europe, and I ran out of funding, and I was worrying about how I was gonna. These things are very complex to fund and difficult to fund. And so I ran out of, I was very worried about how I could go to Europe and do this project about genetic fascism, basically. But then fascism came to America, like the saying, like if Muhammad can come to the mountain, the mountain must come to Muhammad. So it's going to be easier for me to do the project, but it's basically something about genetic warfare.
Okay.
And again, it's satire. Should I say that? Yes, I believe in satire. I believe in the power of satire.
You said that this was an artistic investigation. What were the best or the most valuable lessons that you've learned from that?
Well, people will believe everything you say if you have a suit on. That's
okay.
But. And reality is and reality can be manipulated very easily, and it's something everybody can do.
Okay, I believe we have to wrap it up here. Can we take some questions from the audience? Yeah, thank you very much, Jakob.
Thank you for coming out. That was sweet.
I want to thank everyone for joining us this evening, and especially Jakob and Eva for your amazing questions. It was really wonderful. So thank you. You need to go to the book signing and start signing books. I've got my books ready to be signed, so please pick them up, take a look, and keep talking. Thank you. Yeah.